Good morning, Calvary Chapel Concord. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We just are so blessed, Lord, to be in your presence this morning. And not that we're not, you know, throughout the week, but just corporately coming to worship you and to praise your name, Lord. And we pray that, Father, you would just search our hearts and know us this morning. That, Father, you would just help us to lay things at your throne, at your feet, Lord, and just be done with them, Lord, through just your blood washing and cleansing and your word washing us as well. We pray, Lord, that your word would do that for us this morning. And Lord, just touch us physically, emotionally, and spiritually. That, Lord, we would just gravitate, Lord, back to you and just be so blessed and pleased in your presence and Lord, just the things that you desire to do within us. We're just amazed, Lord, at your goodness and your grace. And we just are so in love with you, Lord. And we just pray that, Father, you would just prep our heart, Lord, for all that you have prepared for us. Father, we could just hear it, listen to it, and apply it, Lord, to our lives. We love you, and we just thank you. We ask for your blessing upon us this morning, Lord. And we ask for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God our evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Upon that cross, and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. 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 Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder great thou art. my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. You are here, moving in our midst, and I worship. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship. is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Thank you, Lord. As the morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of grace that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is strong in my this is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. I'm desperate for you. I'm lost without you. I'm lost without you.
You can stand up.
Only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, and will I keep it above? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or do I need?
by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Oh, Lord, thank you for your presence right here, right now. Lord God, thank you for being here. We just love you so much, God. We just want to pour out our praise and our worship and honor you and glorify you and lift up your great, mighty, awesome, beautiful, holy name. Lord, you're everything that we need. We bow our hearts before you, God, the King of glory, Lord over angels, over demons, over people, over the earth, over the stars, over the sky. Oh, God, we're so in love with you. Thank you so much for making this way so that we can come and fellowship with you, our God Most High. Lord God, we thank you that you have taken these wretches and made us saints. We thank you, God, that we get to walk on holy ground every day before you, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We thank you, God, that you are the great shepherd, that you've called us your sheep, your children, that you love on us every day. You protect us, you keep us, you pour yourself out on us and through us and in us. Thank you, God, for your mercies that are new every morning. Thank you for your kindness to us, your grace, and your love. We bless you, we praise you, we worship you now in Jesus' precious name and for your sake. And everyone said,
amen. Amen.
Love one another.
Yes, sir. Okay, I'll try.
Yeah, I had an ADD appointment. They sent me a letter.
Hey, how are you
today? Called me 2 days before that.
Come on, James.
I'd like to call this meeting to order. Order in the church here. Hey, it's good to have you folks, Calvary Chapel Concord, today. And got up this morning and grabbed Toby and jumped in the truck and went and got a cup of coffee. And a little chilly out, but man, the sun's shining. It's going to be a beautiful day. And God's here. Met me early this morning, looking forward to a great day. We're going to be reading in Psalms 71 today. I'll read the odd verse and you read the even. And we're going to read the first 12 verses. Before I do that, yesterday, some of you at Christmas, she came, little Mary. She's a little friend of mine. We sat right over here. And she played keyboard for me for years. She's 94 years old, and she set wing and went off to heaven this past week. But you know what? It was a blessed thing. She had a stroke about 3 weeks ago, and we went to visit her in a hospital. And she talked with her eyes. She couldn't speak. She couldn't move. She talked with her eyes, and I'm gonna tell you. I've been to a lot of funerals. I've been involved in a lot of funerals. I've sung at them. I've carried caskets. I've done all kinds of things for funerals. But this was a hoot. I mean, we had a time. We rejoiced. She was real big in working with the down and out. Her and her husband, her sister, and her brother-in-law ran Restore here in Concord. And there was a lot of people that she had touched in her life. They were there and they got to testify. You don't realize in your daily walk as a Christian what you do for people. You touch people. And always be ready to do it. You know, you care. And I say that little thing, be the reason someone smiles today. Mary was the reason why I smiled every Sunday. She was just a positive thing to be around. She has that proverbial thumb in my back at times, pushing me to try a little something more. And I knew she prayed for me. And you know what? If you do that, you pray for people, you'd be surprised what it'll do for people. It can change a person. You let the Holy Spirit do the work. You pray. Somebody said, well, I don't know how to testify. I don't know how to go out and talk to somebody. Pray. That's all you got to do. Start everything with prayer. Amen. If you start everything with prayer, you're going to find out things will go better for you. Okay? All right. Pastor's going to get to sing a solo. Okay, verse 1. In you, O Lord, I put my trust. Let me never be put to shame.
Deliver me in your righteousness and cause me to escape. Incline your ear to me and save me.
Be my strong refuge, to which I may resort continually. You have given the commandment to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress.
Deliver me, O my God, out of the hands of the wicked, out of the hand of the unrighteous and cruel man.
For you are my hope, O Lord God. You are my trust from my youth.
By you I have been upheld from birth. You are he who took me out of my mother's womb. My praise shall be continually of you.
I have become as a wanderer to many, but you are my strong refuge.
Let my mouth be filled with your praise and with your glory all day.
Do not cast me off in the time of old age. Thank you, Lord. I don't want you to do that. Do not forsake me when my strength fails.
For my enemies speak against me, and those who lie in wait for my life counsel together.
Saying, God has forsaken him, pursue and take him, for there is none to deliver him.
O God, do not be far from me.
Amen.
Make haste to help me.
Father, it's been so good to come to your house today and together with the church. And we pray as we go further into worship that you'll help us to turn our buckets right side up and open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to the blessings that you have for us. Be with Pastor as he brings the lesson you've laid on his heart today. Speak through him to us. Look in our souls, Father, and purge us, cleanse us. When we walk out of this place today, may we say we've been with the Lord. May we say we're going to walk with the Lord this week and be the reason someone smiles. Thank you for those who have made it here today. We thank you for those who have joined us online. And Lord, today we know we have some that are needing a touch from you physically. And we pray that you go where they are this day. Surround them with your warm, loving hands and arms of healing and strengthen them and raise them up. Be with our first responders. Be with those who are on the front lines, Lord, today. Protect them and keep them. We pray for our government. We pray that you would help us, Lord, to turn to you. There's so many things every morning on the news. Every morning you turn on your phone and you look at the news. You pick up the newspaper, all the things that are going on, people being shot, being held up, just so many things that are going on. Father, we need you. We need you so bad in our world today. You shed blood on the cross on Calvary to cover these things. But we need you to help us, Lord, to turn from sin and become the Christians we need to be. We love you so much. Thank you for all you do and all you're going to do. And we give you the honor and the glory and the praise that becomes that most matchless name, our name, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Well, God is good all the time. Amen. I'm going to try to stand. So if I sit down halfway through the study, you'll know why. Last time we were in verses 1 through 15. This morning we're going to look at one verse. So this is a one-verse study. But last time we learned that Jesus, the Lamb of God, became like the brass snake of Numbers 21. As he was lifted up on the cross to absorb the judgment which should have been ours, he says to Nicodemus, "Look upon me," or "Look to me, and you will be born again." It's so simple, he said. But notice again, there's that word in there, must. Even so, must the Son of Man be lifted up. If there is to be the possibility of redemption, if there's to be an experience of becoming born again, it can only be by the Son of Man being crucified. That's the only way. So must the Son of Man be lifted up. And there's really no physical or scientific explanation for this. It was just God's covenant God's provision. And he said, all you have to do is to look and you will live. Now, people are somewhat foolish. They argue and they die all because they don't understand the process by which God is working. They won't accept it. But listen, I can't explain to you how that believing in Jesus Christ can cleanse you of your sin and cause you to be born again and become a child of God. Can't. All I can tell you is that it does, it will, and it works. That's what God has ordained. That's the way that he's... I mean, think about it, guys. Look at this serpent and you'll be healed. Okay? See you later, you know. It's got to us, we feel like it's got to be rationalized. We've got to be able to understand it, but you can't understand the way that God works. So maybe a little bit, but not a full understanding. And so here's, you know, as we're in John, trying to explain it from his perspective. And it's almost as if he finally comes to a point where, okay, it works. You know, it works. Don't mess with it. They are the result. How can these things be? How can this take place? You know, how can, I mean, believing in Jesus Christ cleanse you of your sin and cause you to be born again and become a child of God? How does that happen? And all I can tell you is that it does work. It does work. So how can these things be, as far as we can understand? They are the result of simply believing in Jesus Christ. That whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. God's provision given to us through faith, like the wind, you may see the effects of it. You may see the results and feel the effects, even though it's a mystery. You can't tell from where it comes. You can't tell where it's going. So is that man that is born of the Spirit. The process is of God's Holy Spirit. We cannot fully understand it, nail it down. We just know that they exist. And so how can a man be born again? How can these things be? Verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The contest rules read in 25 words or less. Tell us why your mother should be the mother of the year. 25 words or less. Why your mother should be the mother of the year. The test question reads, in 25 words or less, explain the importance of the French Revolution upon the economic and social structures of the 13 colonies. Now, although I probably wouldn't have much trouble with the second question, the first one would be extremely difficult for me because the more that we know about any given subject, the harder it is to communicate our thoughts succinctly. It's difficult to put it all down and gather it all from all those years. But you know what? That wasn't a problem with Jesus. It wasn't a problem at all. In fact, John 3:16 is exactly 25 words long. And in these 25 words, Jesus communicates the Father's heart, the Father's plan, and the Father's will. His heart, he loved the world. His plan, he gave his only begotten Son. His will, whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I find it interesting, although I know it's somewhat coincidental, but I find it interesting that in our English translation of this verse, The word in the middle of this verse is son. It's no coincidence, however, that though those who have experienced God's presence most powerfully are those who have made the son the center of their lives. For just as Jesus is the center of the greatest verse in all of Scripture, the Son, he must be central in our hearts and our lives if we're to have any meaning, any purpose, or any impact. He's got to be the center of our lives. And this means that any person, pursuit, or passion in my life which cannot be centered on Jesus Christ really doesn't have a place in my life. For it is God's plan to gather together everything in the heavens and the earth in his Son. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 10. Then surrounding the word Son in this verse, there are 9 other key words that you need to be aware of. They are God, loved, world, gave, whosoever, believes, perish, have, life. Each and every one of them. Key words. And if you want to be really blessed, meditate sometime in that quiet place, quiet time, quiet heart area of your life. But meditate on John chapter 3, verse 16, every day for 10 days, giving emphasis to a different word each day. For God, emphasize God. For God so loved, emphasize loved. For God so loved the world, emphasize the world. Perhaps you memorized this verse when you were 3 years old or 4 years old, but I believe it will come alive for you in new ways as you contemplate its enormity. And so this week we're going to contemplate its enormity. And we're going to look at one of the most famous verses in the Bible. Certainly, it's one of the most important. Perhaps you've seen these numbers before on TV. Roland Stewart and the Rainbow Man, or Tim Tebow in the Florida State Gators, as he played quarterback for him. He had 316 under his cheek with the black reflecting mask. Just signs, maybe perhaps even in the stadium, you look up and you see someone waving a sign that says John 3:16. Outside? You might, yeah, Bobby, you might want to sneak out and let them know that we're having a service. In the meantime, I'll... But Tim Tebow and just signs in the stadium. Martin Luther called it the Bible in miniature. It's also called the little gospel and the comfortable word. Last week, we got to peek in on an appointment at night that Jesus had while he was in Jerusalem with a Jewish man by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, a strict follower of scriptures. He was a good guy. But Jesus told him that he needed to be born again. And Jesus elaborated that this was spiritual birth, that this was a work of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said that this was something that happened through faith. Jesus mentioned in the Old Testament story how the people in the wilderness, as I said, had been bitten by the snakes. You go back to the first mention of it, and we find that God told Moses to make a bronze snake, to put it on a pole, and if anyone was bitten by the snake, they looked and they looked upwards at the bronze snake and believed that they would be healed. Jesus said that, like the bronze snake, he would be himself lifted up. And so Jesus dying on the cross is an essential part of our salvation. Now in our text, just before verse 16 and verse 14, you notice the phrase, the serpent in the wilderness. Again, he was referring to that incident when the children of Israel were in one of their complaining moods. While they were wandering in the wilderness, they were complaining. And God decided to do something to deal with their constant complaining. And so going to the story where it begins in Numbers chapter 21, and in verse 6, it says, "So the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit in people, and many of the people of Israel died." The serpents were kind of a judgment by God on the people's complaining. He goes on in verse 7 in Numbers 21. "Therefore, the people came to Moses and they said, 'We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpent from us.' And so Moses prayed for the people. Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole. And it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live.' And so Moses made a bronze serpent, and he put it on a pole. And so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when they looked at the bronze serpent, they lived. Some, we know, refused to do it. You say, though, how was the person saved by judgment of the serpents? They had to take a simple step of faith. That's all it was. A simple step of faith of looking up to the bronze serpent that Moses had made on the pole. Now, to our normal way of thinking, it didn't make any sense whatsoever. What good is looking at a bronze serpent going to do? And so now at this point, John summarizes this process of salvation with the simple words, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." And so let's break that down for a closer look. For God so loved. So is the word that is operative there, which means in the Greek, in this manner or in this way. And so the word "so" isn't here used to describe the size of God's love, as if, you know, God's love is measurable. You know, it's like, this is that much, that's God's love. Or you might say, no, it's more like this much, you know, or even this much, whatever. But that's not the idea. The idea conveyed in the Greek is meant to get us to look at the thing that was described in the previous verse. Again, we go back to the snake. The people under Moses, verses 14 and 15, they were saved through the bronze serpent being lifted up. So, in this way, in this manner, the way God does things is perplexing. It is puzzling to us. We don't quite understand it. I mean, all you got to do is think about some issues that you're involved in or some situations that you're dealing with or trying to overcome. And when you begin to deal with those things in your life, you know, you think you've got God figured out, but you don't. You know, you think you've got the way that he's going to deal with it, but you're off course. And so here in this way, God is coming and saying, in this manner, and again, for God so loved the world. God so loved the world. And so here again is not used to describe. Hang on just a second. Sorry. It's not used here to describe the quantity necessarily. But he's saying, you are saved through this bronze serpent being lifted up on a pole. And the people looking and believing in this way, in this manner of lifting up his own son on the cross, God has loved the world through that. And so God loved apageo in the Greek. There's several words we know in the Greek used various times to express one English word, the word love. For our word love, they have several, and one of them is eros, which is a word that means physical or sexual love. Sturgios is a word that is used for family love, as between a parent and a kid. Phileo was used for affection or friendship, an emotional feeling between two people. But none of these words are used here. Rather than being centered in the hormones, eros, family relationships, sturgios, are in the emotions, phileo. It's a love that's based upon choice, a choice that you make. It's centered in the will. It's the choice that a person makes to place value on another person. It is an unconditional kind of love in the sense that it depends not on the object to meet certain requirements, but on the lover who chooses to love. Choosing unconditional value. This is the same kind of love that a husband is to have towards his wife. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, it says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her." The kind of love a husband is commanded to have is a love that's based upon personal commitment. It's a love that's based upon a husband's choice to love his wife. A lot of people come in and say, "I just fell out of love." No, you don't fall out of love. You make a choice, a decision to fall out of love. And it's not about whether she can still fit into a certain dress size or not anymore. It's not about her abilities in the kitchen, but it's simply because he has chosen to love her. He has chosen to place a high value on her in his heart. This is the same kind of love that we are all supposed to have towards one another. 1 John chapter 3:16, interestingly enough, it says, "By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren." Isn't that interesting? 3:16. So John 3:16 is what we're looking at. You know, the first verse, but the second verse is also 3:16. And it's interesting. Sometimes it gets hard loving certain people. You know, it does. It doesn't hurt. I mean, sometimes to come back to the 3:16s and just kind of plant yourself there for a while. Why? Because we learn to love by seeing how God loved us. By this we know that he loved. By this we know about love. Because he laid down his life for us. And we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. And so God so loved the world. The world is the word cosmos. The universe. The inhabitants of the universe. God's love is not just for nice people. It's not just for people who are going to respond by saying, "Oh, I'll follow Jesus." But God loves the entire world, dirty, rotten sinners included. Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says, "But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." While we were still out partying, while we were still out doing all the things that we used to do, God's love was being demonstrated towards us. So God so loved the world that he gave, that word "that" in so much that. The grammar conveys that the practical result of God's love was giving. The expected result of God's love for the world was that he gave his son. That was the expected result. Why? Because God had agape love. He had to give his son. What did it mean for God to give his son? Well, it meant that Jesus had to take on human flesh. It meant that Jesus would one day die on a cross as a sacrifice for our sins. In the book of Genesis, God asked Abraham to do a horrible thing, right? God asked Abraham to sacrifice his only begotten son, Isaac. We now know that what God was asking Abraham to do was to paint a picture for future generations. When Isaac and Abraham were going up the mountain for this sacrifice, you remember that Isaac became a little bit curious as to why they didn't have a lamb for the sacrifice. And there in Genesis chapter 22, verse 8, it says that, "And Abraham said, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering." And so the two of them went together. And when Abraham was up, they had built the altar, and there Isaac was laying, and Abraham was ready. He raised the knife to the sacrifice, his son. And God stopped Abraham from killing his son. When he did that, the picture was complete. A father would one day sacrifice his only son, and God would provide a lamb. Here's one of the primary qualities of agape love. It is simply characterized by giving. Love, agape love, has to give. Why did God have to give his son? Because he saw the problem of our sin, our separation. The Bible says, we have all sinned. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I know some people are not happy to be labeled sinners. I'm not a sinner. But the truth is that this is what we all are. The Bible says that there's a price tag that comes attached to our sin. In Romans 6:23, he expounds upon that and says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. God thinks that this price tag for sin is higher than he wants you to pay. Can you imagine? Higher than he wants you to pay for. It's like going to the restaurant with friends and you get towards the end of the meal and you're scrounging for your money. And someone at the table takes the tab, signs it off, and completely takes care of it. That person most likely did that because they wanted to bless you, because they wanted to knowingly what you maybe perhaps your situation is. They wanted to take care of that. And in that sense, God thinks that this price tag for sin is higher than he wants you to pay. So he steps in. And Jesus paid a debt he didn't owe because you owed a debt you couldn't pay. He paid a debt he did not owe because you owed a debt you couldn't pay. This is why God gave to us his son, his only begotten son. Single means single of its kind. The word indicates that Jesus had a unique relationship with the Father. We are all children of God, but Jesus is the only begotten of God. Now, it doesn't mean that Jesus was some sort of created being, but it does refer to the fact that as the eternally existing Word, he came down from heaven, he put on flesh, and was born from the womb of a virgin by the name of Mary. Now, I have to admit that since I've been a dad, I've looked at this verse just a little bit different. Ever since my sons were born, I had a whole new appreciation for the words used here, like father and son. I know what it's like to hold your baby, my baby, in my arms, and just feel this overwhelming flood of feelings come over you as you look into your baby's eyes. God didn't just go out to the store and buy $10 worth of groceries for us. It was far more than that. He didn't just take us to a restaurant and pay the tab. What he did is he gave his son for us. Most of you might remember the story about a father and a son and a railroad bridge. It was made into an award-winning short film called Most. You can look at it on YouTube. I was going to show a portion of it, but it's kind of long. But this award-winning short film was made. It was called Most, M-O-S-T. And it was made in Czechoslovakia. And it's a story of a single dad and the treasure of his life, his little son, Lado. And the Father is the bridge guy, the guy that raises the bridge for boats to pass in the river and then lowers the bridge for the trains to cross the river. One day, Leto gets to come to work with Dad, and he's eager to help his dad with the bridge. And as the story unfolds, initially, the focus is upon the passenger and the stories of their life and what they're going through and struggles that they're struggling with in their journey. And so that's all going on. They're getting on the train and getting ready to go. And then continuing, the boy gets someplace where he's not supposed to be and he gets stuck in the gears. And it happens to be just as the train approaches the father and his little, you know, place that he pulls switches and does those things. And the father is forced to either put the bridge down immediately or send the people on the train to certain death. And he just is just losing it, you know, understandably. But the bridge is put down, and as it does, it crushes his beloved son. And as the train goes by, you can watch the faces and the folks that are on the train and notice how much they weren't even aware of what this father had just done for them. And I don't know that we're really aware that much of what our Father, our Heavenly Father, has done. Do you realize how much God loves you? He really loves you guys. He loves us. He's freely given to us a priceless gift. God, understandably, could just use this against us. He could have used it to make us feel guilty over the great sacrifice that he has given to us. You know people like that? Who have given you a gift and then they make you feel guilty for taking it because it was such a great sacrifice for them. But you know what? That wasn't God's purpose in sending Jesus. His purpose was to demonstrate just how great his love is for us. How awesome it is. Romans chapter 8, verse 32, it says, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things, comparatively speaking? If he did that, if he gave you his son, don't you think there's much more that he would willingly and does willingly want to give to us? Like God's Holy Spirit. All the pleasurable things that God has in store for us. How much more? You know, that's why you hear me say all the time, if God did nothing more than send his son to die for us, it would be enough. Plenty enough. Amen? But he doesn't just do that. He continues on. There may be times in your life when you'll begin to question whether God loves you. It's usually during times of difficulty that we begin to think this. Sometimes it's when God doesn't answer a prayer like we want it to be answered, or doesn't answer it at all. And at those times, we need to go back to the basics and recall just what God has done for us, just the things that he's done. Count your blessings, guys. If God allows difficulty in your life, or if he doesn't answer your prayer the way you want it, understand that it's because of the great love that he has for you. He goes on, that whosoever, I like that word, whosoever. Raul Reese's son, Ryan, started a ministry, and the ministry is called the Whosoevers. And they go out and they minister to you know, kids that are at skate parks and kids in high school, and they bring bands in and they just teach the gospel. They give the gospel. And it's just a real blessing to see him work, because I remember when I was on staff, Ryan was a kid about this tall, and he thought for the world that he was the Hulk, and I was some other bad guy, so I had to avoid him in the hallways. Otherwise, when he was there at the time visiting, he'd come up and attack. The whosoever. Whosoever. And some of the people that they minister to, you just think, man, yeah, that's a whosoever, but that whosoever is not interested in Jesus. That's not up for us to determine, though. This is, though, the purpose for which God gave his Son, that we might have a chance to believe, that whosoever next believes in him. Jesus told the story about Moses lifting up that bronze serpent. And as a result of the people looking, they believed and they were saved. Now he's going to reiterate it again. You must believe in God's Son. You know, the means by which God saved us was for God to have Jesus be the sacrificial sacrifice for our sins. The method by which we receive God's payment for our sins is faith. Some people may think that God's ways changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament. And they would tell you that in the Old Testament you were saved by keeping the law, but in the New Testament you're saved by faith. But that's not true. It's always been about faith. The people in Moses' day were saved from the fiery serpents by putting their faith in this, frankly, odd method. Looking up at the bronze serpent, it was faith. It was an act of faith. You know, are you kidding me? You're going to look at that bronze serpent and think that it's going to save you? You better find some place that's got anti-venom. You better go here. You better go there. You better, you know, all these conclusions, all these answers and such that we can bring up and think of, and we're frantically going about trying to figure out what the answer is. And then we come to find out that the answer is looking at the bronze serpent standing right in the middle of the group. Just look at it. Just look at it. Satan's going, don't look at it, don't look at it. Don't do it. Don't do it. And there's that battle going on, back and forth. And our Heavenly Father requires faith. He requires faith. It requires faith to please God. He wants his children to trust him. He wants you and I to trust him, to believe in him. It's not just enough for God to give the whole world the gift of his Son. For the gift to be of any value to you, you got to accept it. So it's not just giving the Son, it's the acceptance of that. If a girl gets a dozen long-stem roses delivered to her door, but it's from somebody that she doesn't like, what do? Well, she might end up refusing the gift. The man who sent the roses might think he's doing something to further his cause with this woman. But if she refuses the gift, then they haven't accomplished anything. Believing is like the key to a locked door. To get through the door, you have to insert the key and you have to turn it. Well, to receive God's salvation from your sin, you need to learn to believe. Believing is not just an intellectual assent. Believing is trusting. It's putting your confidence in something. It's not just agreeing in your mind that Jesus died for your sins. It's putting your whole confidence in God's plan to save you. It's placing your entire eternal destiny in God's hand. And then trusting that Jesus' sacrifice for you was enough to secure a place in heaven. When you came in this morning, you believed in your chair. You know that? How do I know that? Because you're sitting in it still, aren't you? You've entrusted your entire body weight to that chair. What if I had gone around and clipped each one with a soldering or a torch so that it would fail when you sat down? You didn't even think about that. You didn't think about that. You've entrusted your entire body weight to that chair. And you expect it to keep you up off the floor for the entire church service. Then in the John 3:16 again, should not perish. Perish is an interesting word. It's to destroy, to perish, to be lost. Speaking of eternal misery in hell. The word perish is a word used to describe what happens to a person who refuses to accept God's free gift of salvation. It's important that we have a correct concept of this. Some teach that since this word in the Greek literally means to destroy, that when a person dies without salvation, that their soul is literally annihilated. In other words, once they're dead, that's all there is, Fred. Right? And really, to be honest with you, that would be much nicer than the truth. The Greek word does indeed mean to destroy, but the false concept some have is that this destruction would someday be completed. The truth is that every single human being will live forever. Some will live forever with Jesus in heaven. Some will live forever apart from Jesus. Which begs the next question. So, what is hell like? On a church sign outside of Atlanta, the name of the church, the name of the minister, and then under that, the title of the sermon. The title of the sermon was, "Do You Know What Hell Is?" And then underneath that title, in capital letters, it read, "Come, hear our organist Sunday morning." Yeah. There's a common idea that hell is where you're going to party forever with your friends. Actually, it's far from a laughing matter. Jesus gave a good picture of what hell is like when he described a rich man arriving in hell in Luke chapter 16, verse 23. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and he saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried out and he said, "Father Abraham, had many sons." And stop it. Then he cried out and he said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. For I am tormented in this flame." We find, guys, that it's a place of eternal torment. In Isaiah chapter 66, 24, "And they shall go forth and look upon the corpses of the men who have transgressed against me. For their, listen, worm does not die, and their fire is not quenched." There's a lot of verses you probably looked at what hell's about, but this one is really, really scary, really, for those that don't know the Lord. "For their worm does not die, and their fire is not quenched. They shall be an abhorrence to all flesh." And let me tell you what the picture is here. The picture is that of a person's body being consumed by worms. Can you imagine? Consumed by worms, but in a way that never ends. So there's no end. It's just a little, I don't even, you know, what the deal is with those worms. But you don't want to find out. Be where Jesus wants you to be, guys. No, of this picture of him being consumed, but being consumed in a way where the body never stops being consumed. The body will somehow endure and not waste away, but be under constant decomposition. Constant decomposition. You look at your arm and it's just like, okay. You know, it just keeps going. And the first thing that people say is, how can a God of love send someone to hell? Well, you're right in calling him a God of love, because he is a God of love. The truth is that God has done the one and only thing to keep you from going to hell. And that is that he paid the price for your sins by sending his only son. And all you have to do is receive God's payment for you by believing and following after Jesus. The question you should be asking yourself is, why would I be so dumb as to refuse God's offer of salvation through Jesus? Why would I refuse everlasting life? Why would anybody refuse an everlasting life? And as I said before, everyone will indeed live forever. But this is talking about living forever with Jesus in heaven. The Greek word carries an emphasis on the immeasurableness of eternity. Eternity is a long, long time, which prompts the next question, and that is, what is heaven like? We heard about hell. Well, what I know about heaven is that, number one, and this is a different way perhaps for you to look at it, but number one, heaven is not boring. You believe that? Psalm chapter 16, verse 11. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. What is he talking about? He's talking about an inexhaustible source of joy, to the fact of a fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore. Can you imagine? It's better than you could even imagine. I should have said that. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart, hasn't entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Not only that, it's where Jesus is. Revelation chapter 21, verse 3 and 4. It says, and I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eye. There shall be no more death, no sorrow, no crying, no crying, no crying. There shall be no more pain. Oh, thank you, Lord. I'm feeling it. For the former things have passed away. Everything's become new. And it starts now. John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief does not come except to steal and kill and destroy. And I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. You don't have to wait until you die to experience everlasting life. It's a quality of life that brings you or begins when you open your heart and you believe in Jesus. Open your heart, believe in Jesus, and you experience that quality of life. And if you haven't opened your heart already to Jesus Christ, what are you waiting for? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him, whosoever, might have life eternally. Spend some time in that, you guys. You know, find a quiet place, quiet time, and with a quiet heart, open your heart to that verse and see what the Lord would do. Amen. Father, we just thank you. We love you. We are amazed at you, astounded with you, Lord, and just with the way that you look at things, how you love us, revealing how you loved us and continue to love us. That even when we sin, Lord, even when we blow it, your love is constant. And Lord, we can depend on it, rely upon it mightily. We pray, God, that you would just continue, Lord, through your word to reveal yourself to us. Thank you, Lord, for the Gospel of John. Thank you, Lord, for your word to us, your promise. May we, Lord, just be open, receptive. Lord, may we not get in the way of the work that you want to do and you desire to do. And Lord, as we come, I pray that you would just welcome us with open arms, that we could just receive, Lord, all that you have for us, all that you have stored up, including those things we missed out on because of our stubbornness, our rebellion, Lord. Thank you so much for your love and your grace and your mercy. And I pray that, Lord, for those that already knew you, that there would be a re-examining upon these issues, Lord. That, Father, we are just exactly where you want us to be. Exactly in the position that will be at the spout where the blessings come out. That, Father, we could just enjoy, again, all that you have, all that you pleasures, everything, Lord. We love you so much. And I pray for any out there that don't know you, that, Father, there would be just a responding to your Holy Spirit. Even now, Lord Jesus. Pray that, Father, for those that have been with you for a long time, that, Lord, they haven't grown cold in any way. And if they have, Lord, that they would take this as a challenge, Father, to read these things and make sure that they're really where you want them to be. And if sin is still there, that, Lord, you would reveal to them how to deal with it. Lord, bless your people. Bless them, Lord, with your mighty grace, mercy, love, and the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask this now in your precious name. And everyone said, your love is devoted, like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain
and beyond the horizon. Pledge yourself to me, and it's why I sing your praise. Ever be on my lips,
ever be on my lips,
your praise. Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, kindness makes us whole. You hold it on.
Let's stand together as we close the service today. It's good to be with you, be with the Lord, be in his house. And pastor's wife told me I could do this. So if he says anything, I just send him to see his wife. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son. To die on Calvary's tree, from sin to set me free. One day he's coming back, what glory that will be. Wonderful his love to me. Father, it's been good to be with the people of the church today. We pray as we go our separate ways that we'll keep in mind what we've heard and that we'll use it in our walk this week. Give us a holy boldness as we go into this world and help us to stand up and represent the right. And Lord, as we said earlier, it really helps if we pray before we get there. We let the Holy Spirit set the mood. And Lord, help us to keep that in mind. And Lord, we thank you for all that we've heard. And we pray again for those who need a touch from you, those who are ill today. And Lord, we're praising you for Larry's surgery on his eyes. It came through well. Thank you for going with him and being through that. And there's others facing things that they have to go through, waiting for test results, waiting for things that, procedures and all. Oh, Father, be with them. Give them comfort. Now we ask that the lesson, the offering that was given today, will you bless it and use it and multiply it for your ministry and to propagate the word that you have of salvation. We pray these things in thy precious name. And everyone said, Amen.